guys. Welcome back to my channel. Hopefully the sound is a little bit better in this one than it was in the last one. Did y'all hear that? I swear. I've been trying to get this video filmed all day, and man, it is just not happening. But I had a lot to do today, and Tuesdays are busy. I don't know why I thought that I could film on a Tuesday. Welcome back, you guys. My name is Jessica. If this is your first time here, I'm a woman in long-term recovery. I suffer from a 14-year drug addiction of opiates, mainly. But I gave a fair shake to pretty much everything I could get my hands on. And now I am living a life that is beyond my wildest dreams. Every day I get to experience something new that I never thought would be possible. So just keep in mind that even if you think recovery isn't possible, or that if you recover, things are going to be vanilla and it's going to be boring and something that you don't want to do or something that you can't do, I'm here to tell you that you can, and it is far from boring. And you can live a life that is beyond your wildest dreams, like seriously. And that's not to say that I'm out here doing anything crazy, but the life that I live now is honestly just what most people would consider normal. And, you know, people like us that have suffered through addiction and suffer with mental health issues and fight that battle every day, you know, a quote-unquote normal life is something that we have wanted all our lives. So when we actually obtain it and get it, we don't take it for granted. It's something that we have wanted all our lives, and when we get it, we're very grateful for it. So now in my recovery, I am a certified peer recovery specialist. So every day of my life, I get to help people that are still in active addiction or are new to recovery, and I get to go around and teach people about harm reduction. I can teach people, I'm a certified Narcan teacher, trainer, not teacher. So, you know, I never thought that I would get to do the things that I'm doing now, and it's great. And for a very long time in my life, I dreaded waking up every day, and I used to honestly pray to God every day not to wake me up. And now I'm just so happy, you know, when I wake up, and I'm just, you know, I look forward to the things that I get to do every day and the people that I get to talk to. And it's just, it's amazing what your life can be in recovery. And, you know, I just am very grateful that I get to spread that message and be a walking testament and show people that it's possible no matter what. No matter what you've done in your addiction, no matter what people have said about you or what you think people think about you or anything like that, it doesn't matter. You know, every wall can be climbed over. There are things that we do when we're in active addiction that you may not be able to go back and fix, but we can learn, you know, we can learn to like, make amends for it, and just go on about living our life in a better way and just keep doing the next right thing. And, you know, it's just an amazing thing. It really is. When I first entered into my recovery, I thought that people were full of shit. And, you know, it's amazing the things that I've seen my friends in the recovery community accomplish and things that they are doing now and things that I personally have been able to see myself do. So, you know, that's my little, gosh, I almost said TED talk, but that would have, in light of today's video, that would have been a little disrespectful. I wanted to come on and do today's video because I'm constantly watching TED Talks and reading books and stuff about addiction. And like I said, I am a certified peer recovery specialist. And I spend a lot of time talking to addicts that are still in active addiction. But sometimes that gives me an opportunity to talk to family members of addicts that are in addiction. I have a lot of addiction in my family, addiction and alcoholism. But my stepmom and my dad are not addicts. They're not alcoholics. Keith, my boyfriend, he's neither one. He's never struggled with addiction. He's never really, you know, when he was younger, he drank. but he doesn't drink now. He hasn't drank in a very long time. It was never something that he had to struggle with to put down. You know, he didn't like have to hit a rock bottom, quote unquote, before he would give it up. So I have that kind of perspective, you know, a non-using perspective in my life. But a lot of times when I talk to family members of addicts that I'm talking to in a peer capacity or a group capacity or anything like that, it's very enlightening, because my family is mostly made up of addicts. And unfortunately, I went a very long time in my life without being able to have my dad and my stepmom in my life, because of circumstances that were out of both of our control. And, you know, we're fixing that relationship now, and it's one of my favorite gifts of recovery is being able to have that relationship with them now. But, you know, I didn't have that when I was in my active addiction. I didn't have that when I got in the early stages of my recovery. So sometimes hearing other people's family members, you know, talk about what it's like to have someone in their family be an addict is very enlightening to me. And I always try to pay attention to that, because knowledge is power, you know, and it helps me help the next person. But I came across a TED Talk the other day, and I'll try to remember to link it down below. You guys let me know if I don't link it down below and you're interested in watching it, because I'll be completely honest with you. When I first watched it, the girl that was talking on there pissed me off. And there are parts of what she said, you know, that still piss me off, because there was so much on it that I had to, like, make notes so I could try to cover all of it in this video. And if it, I try to make my videos a little bit shorter so you don't have to sit there for so long and watch them. So I'm going to try to just break it into parts. If it goes over too long, you know, then I'll just break it into like a part one and a part two. But she is, it's called Wasted, Exposing the Family Effect of Addiction. And her name is Sam Fowler. And she was able to do a TED Talk because they came to her university, and her oldest brother is an addict. And she's not an addict. No one else in her family is an addict, but her older brother is. And the thing that, one of the first things that, you know, kind of hit me the wrong way when she started talking was, she started talking about how when she was in school, not college, but like high school, they went to a family rehab to teach them, you know, how to deal with her brother's addiction, which I'm all for, because I can't imagine me being an addict myself, you know, I can't imagine. And that's why I always try to pay attention to what other families are talking about if I get the chance to talk to a family member that is, you know, a family member of an addict, because I don't know. I don't have that lived experience. I have the lived experience of an addict, but I don't have the lived experience of a non-addict. So I wanted to listen to what this girl said, and I listened to it all the way through, and it made me mad. And then by the end of it, I was like, you know, she brings up some valid points. And then I went back another day and I listened to it again, because, you know, I try to be more grown up about things than what I used to be, especially when I was in active addiction and in early recovery, because I wasn't the nicest person, especially when I was in active addiction. But she talks about going to this family rehab, and she says on there, you know, as far as all my friends knew and as far as Snapchat knew, we were at a a resort in Palm Beach or some shit like that. And I'm like, fuck me. And all I could think of, because I'm an addict, you know, because that's my lived experience, because that is how my mind operates, all I could think about was not, you know, this poor girl going through it. I do have sympathy for her. But I have sympathy for her brother, because can you imagine how he felt? Because you know that he knew that his family was going away for a weekend to learn how to deal with him. And whether he thought that that was a valid thing or not at that time in his addiction, can you imagine how he felt to go on any of his social media and see that his baby sister was acting like they were on a vacation, that she was hiding him, that she was ashamed of him? And I say that because that's one of the things that addicts deal with on a day-to-day basis at any point in time in our lives. And it doesn't matter if we're in active addiction. It doesn't matter if we're in recovery. It doesn't matter if we've been in recovery a day, a week, a month, a year, 5 years, 10 years, 50 years. If you tell someone that you're an addict, even if you follow it up with, I'm an addict, but I've been in recovery for X amount of years, you see 9 out of 10 people, you see a change come over their face. You see that judgment come into their eyes. I've had people take a physical step back away from me. And that's not even if I throw in all the other fun facts of, oh, I'm a 3-time convicted felon. I'm a single mom. I had a child out of wedlock. Like, you know, I'm really throwing caution to the wind here, y'all. So can you imagine how her brother felt to go on and see, you know, he knew where his damn family was. He knew why they were there. And I always try to tell people that are dealing with addiction in some capacity in their lives, not being the addict themselves, you know, but they have a loved one that is going through addiction. If you guys can hear that beeping, I'm sorry. I forgot to close the window in the living room, and the school bus is backing out in front of my house. It's backing up in front of my house. But, you know, I always try to tell people that regardless of what you think, you know, we as addicts carry so much shame and so much guilt that we really don't need yours on top of it. We beat ourselves up for our addiction all day, every day. And it's not something that we have to wait for recovery to happen. It's an all day thing. It really is. You know, when at the height of my addiction, I was doing quite a large amount of drugs every day. And there was always, always, always a voice in the back of my head telling me what a shit person I was and how ashamed of myself I should be. And you know, it's just a constant reel that goes on in your head telling you what a crap person you are because you're an addict, you know? And that's just if you're an addict and you have a place to live and have a job. Like, I had a place to live and I had a job, a place that was mine most of the time. Sorry, y'all. My nose keeps running. Never runs until I turn on the camera. It runs. But, you know, like, I don't understand how people can think that other people can go through something so devastating and so heavy as an addiction, and we just go through it footloose and fucking fancy free. I don't understand that. I would never understand that. I don't understand how people think that we can just, you know, that we literally just wake up one day and think that we want to be drug addicts. we don't. I can assure you, and I've heard this said so many times, you know, nobody just wakes up one morning and says, well, you know what? I did all that I ever wanted to do in my life as of yesterday, so today I'm going to be a drug addict. And then, you know, we find out we're really good at it, so we just go hard, and that's what we do. That is not what happens. That's not what happens, y'all. That's not what happens, and I don't know that I will ever understand how humans can lack that compassion to think that, and to think that it's okay to, like, honest to God, hide your loved one and hide where you are and what you're doing when you're doing something to not only help yourself, but to help your loved one. This girl went with her family to go, you know, to a family rehab is what she calls it. I can't remember because I didn't write it down, you know. I would assume it's like a weekend retreat at Al-Anon. And, you know, we all know what assuming does, you know. It turns me into an asshole. But I just, you know, I think of all that her brother was going through at that time. They seem to be a very affluent family. And she talks about that in her TED Talk. Because later on in the TED Talk, she talks about how easily it could have been her. Because she talks about how people ask her, you know, because now she doesn't hide him. She talks about the shame of it and the stigma of telling people that she has a brother that has a drug addiction problem, and that now she realizes it's a disease, but she struggled with that at first. You know, and it's a really good TED Talk, and you can tell that that she's young, and that it definitely had some mental and emotional impacts on her. And I can vouch for that in a way, because, you know, I grew up in a house where my mom and my stepdad are raging alcoholics, like now, you know. My mom kind of giggles about it now because it's funny, I guess, to her. Or she's one of those people that laughs when she's in awkward situations. I don't know. So, you know, it does fuck you up to watch people that you love and that you look up to do things like that, because it did me. It has a very detrimental effect on you when you watch that day in and day out of your life. And, you know, like I've said before, it makes you think, well, maybe that's normal. And I'm not saying that that is what this girl's family life was, because it doesn't sound like it was at all. Not what it was at all. It sounds like they're, you know, they were like living the American dream with the 2.5 kids and the picket fence and all that. You know, it was just something that her brother tried it one day and it turned that switch in his brain. But yeah, anyway, I kind of went off there. But she says, the next thing that got me, and honestly, when I heard her say this, I had to turn it off the first time that I watched it, because I have a big problem, obviously, about the stigma around addicts and around addiction, because I fight it every day, because I am an addict. I'll be an addict until the day I die. And because 9 times out of 10, when I go out in public, I'm advertising it. So I guess in a way, people say, well, you know, I'm asking for it, I guess. But, you know, I say I'm advertising it because I wear shirts out that say sober or recovery, or, you know, breaking the stigma of addiction or whatever. So, you know, I make no bones about it. I'm sober and I'm fucking proud of that, because I had to fight for that. For a very long time, I had to fight for that. But, I I do not like when people add to the stigma of addiction and addicts. I don't like when they do it unconsciously. And I don't like when people do it very consciously. And I feel like whatever program her and her family went to over the weekend, where she was able to take pictures of palm trees and sunny beaches and fool all her friends on Snapchat into thinking that she was at some, weekend retreat with her family, they consciously made an effort to tell her, and I'm going to quote her directly here. "Addiction is actually more dangerous for family members than for the addict themselves. Because in the worst moments of addiction, the addict is numb, completely unconscious to who they are and what they are feeling. But the family is sober." And, just the first part of that, the addiction is actually more dangerous for family members than for the addict themselves. That's the direct quote. The rest of it I paraphrased. I had to turn it off. Because I can tell you, if you've watched my story, you already know this. I was in active addiction for 14 years. And when I tell you I went hard on my active addiction, I went hard. Because my drug of choice went very quickly from the lowest level pain pill I could find to the highest. And my tolerance went up very quickly. And no matter how hard I tried, at no point during my addiction was I numb. And I tried. I could numb the edges of it. But at no point during my addiction was I ever numb. And I think that's a common misconception that a lot of people have. They think, that we just walk around in this drug-filled haze. And that we can feel nothing. And that is the main point of why I wanted to come on here and make this video today. Because that is absolutely not true. Speaking for myself, I guess I should say. That is absolutely not true. The majority of addicts that I know, and speaking for myself from my own personal experience, one of the main reasons that people use drugs is because we carry so much emotional trauma that we do not know how to deal with it. And the very first time that we do drugs, it flips a switch in us. And it kind of gives us an escape. And being numb is one of the ways that we most often describe our addiction. Especially when we get in recovery and people start asking, well, why did you do it? Or even when you're still in active addiction, when people ask you, well, why do you do it? Why did you do it? Why do you do it? Whichever question it is, because it makes you feel numb. And, that's an easy way out. And very often, if you answer people's questions that way, it cuts them off and they stop asking. But most addicts on a day-to-day basis are feeling more emotional and mental pain than what quote-unquote normal people are feeling on a day-to-day basis. And we just don't, we've never been taught the coping skills to deal with that. And that's why we turn to drugs. Because it doesn't numb us. It just makes us not fucking care. We stop caring about why, whatever it is that is hurting us so bad. And we can stop for just a little while asking all those questions that we may never have an answer to. So it's not necessarily that we're numb. It's that we can just stop caring about it for a little while and lay it down. And while that is a relief in a lot of ways, in a lot of ways it's not, because it's always there. It's kind of like trying to put a wall up to give you privacy that you can see through, pretty much. You know, it's like putting up a chain link fence for privacy. Yeah, the wall's there, and it kind of gives you a little bit of separation, but as far as privacy goes, you can still see through it. So whatever it was you're trying to protect yourself from is still there. You can still see it. It can still see you. You know it's there, and if it really wants to, it can get over that fence. So that's kind of what drug use is like. And this is going to be kind of abrupt, but I'm looking down at my timer, and I'm at 26 minutes. So I think there's a couple places in here that I might be able to cut out or whatever. But I'm really going to try to start keeping my videos below 30 minutes. So for now, I'm going to turn this one off, and we will talk about the rest of this TED Talk. Because, like I said, I got a lot of notes over here and a lot more stuff that I want to talk to you guys about. So that's it for today. Let me do all the YouTube things before I forget. Please subscribe if you haven't subscribed yet, because I can see it in my analytics that people are watching and not subscribing. So please subscribe if you haven't subscribed yet. Give me a thumbs up if you like this video. Please comment down below and let me know if the sound is any better, if it's not fading in and out, or if it is fading in and out, how you feel about the video, anything. Like this video if you liked it, all that good stuff. And you should see this video on Wednesday. And the next one should be uploaded on Friday. So you guys be careful, stay safe, watch out for each other, stay alive, test your supplies, and do not be the gatekeeper on anybody's sobriety. Do not let anybody be the gatekeeper on your sobriety.